this birthmark on my skin. I'm guided by the beauty of our weapon. First, we take Manhattan. Then we take Berlin. As a loser, but now you're worried that I just might win. You know the way to stop me. How but you don't have the discipline. How many nights I prayed for this to let my work begin. First, we take Manhattan. Then we take Berlin. Don't like your fashion business, mister. And I don't like these drugs that keep you thin. I don't like what happened to my sister. First, we take Manhattan. Then we take Berlin.
I'd really like to live beside you, baby. I love your body and your spirit and your clothes. But you see that line that's moving through the station.
Items that you sent me. I mean a monkey and the plywood violin. I've practiced every night, now I am ready. First, we take Manhattan. Then we take Berlin. I used to live for music. Remember me, I brought your groceries in. Well, it's Father's Day and all the men are wounded. First, we take Manhattan. Then we take Berlin.
Take this a little further to the disciple bands that have won Sisters of Mercy, called themselves by Name of Your Song, and I believe in Joy Division the lead singer did commit suicide, I was told. Do you think they indulge in a kind of romantic depression rather than tackling the more lucid aspects of your multi-meanings?
I don't know. I wouldn't like to think that I'm responsible for anybody's self-destruction. I think in the sense that some young musicians have been influenced by my work, I don't think it's the actual content of the work, but the position of the singer to his work that has influenced them. I think a certain seriousness has impressed some of the young musicians. A certain position that refuses to compromise.
Had Suzanne not gained popularity through Judy Collins, would you have, and let's say your first album had not gained a kind of reputation, would you have chosen a different approach to songwriting to try to gain popularity?
Well, I never wrote a song that I didn't want to be popular, and my songs were very popular at a certain moment. That moment changed, and my popularity declined, certainly in North America. But fortunately, I had a modest audience that has continued and grown in Europe, so I can't really assume the role of the neglected genius. I'm not comfortable with that role. I've been very lucky. I've been very fortunate. I've been, in a modest way, paid very well for the work I've done.
How successful have your novels been?
They were quite successful, finally. When I first put out Favorite Game, maybe it sold a couple of thousand copies here and there in England, America, and Canada. Same thing with Beautiful Losers. The reviews were stunning, and the critical acclaim was extremely clear. I was a writer of some talent. The only thing is that I couldn't pay my grocery bills. So it became clear to me that I had to do something. In hindsight, it seems the height of folly to try to resolve your economic problems by becoming a singer. But that's what I did try to do, and it worked for a while.
So how did the success of your novels compare to your success as a cult songwriter in the late 60s?
When my records became popular in the late 60s, all my books were reissued as in paperback. And then there were quite substantial sales. A book like Beautiful Losers, which sold maybe 4,000 copies hardback, eventually sold 1 million in paperback.
But it, as you say, that wasn't your strategy. It just happened that way.
Yes, the books were ignored. Except for, as I say, a few stunning reviews, the books were generally ignored, certainly in this country. In Canada, I had a different position because there are very few of us, and we're given perhaps undeserved attention, the few of us that arise, certainly at that time.
And would you say your style of living changed in that period of time as you ascended in popularity?
My style of living hasn't changed very much.
And what has your style of living been?
Well, to begin with the environment, I've always needed a room and a table and a chair.
Everybody knows that the dice are loaded. Everybody rolls with their fingers crossed. Everybody knows the war is over. Everybody knows that the good guy's lost. Everybody knows the fight was fixed. The poor stay poor, the rich get rich. That's how it goes. Everybody knows. Everybody knows that the boat is leaking. Everybody knows that the capitalize. Everybody got this broken feeling, like their father or their dog just died. Everybody talking to their pockets, everybody wants a box of chocolates and a long stem rope. Everybody knows.
Well, if the world is in order and everybody knows that the deal is fixed and the captain lied, are you trying to change any of that?
You know, at certain moments, and this is one of them, you know, I feel that all my positions are somewhat ludicrous. Everybody Knows is a song that begins with a kind of street smart proposition that everybody knows that the dice are loaded. Everybody rolls with their fingers crossed. But in this litany of street smart catastrophe, it's a song. There's a beat and there's a jaunty rhythm and there's a soaring chorus where everybody sings, everybody knows. So the song contradicts itself. These kinds of observations, true as they might be, are transcended by the singing.
And first we take Manhattan. You've mentioned boredom before, and you've mentioned being a loser, but you see that line there moving through the station, I told you, I told you, I told you, I was one of those. Who are you in that song?
That chorus refers to all those newsreel pictures we've seen of the dispossessed moving through the train station.
The bag people.
The bag people on the most obvious level. The homeless on the most obvious level. The refugees on the most obvious level. But even those people in apparently more secure or profitable situations who feel that they have not yet arrived at any significant destination.
Well, the songwriter who can't cut it, who wants to, but he's got to take a job. So he's kind of sold out his heart to that job, to money, to pay the rent. Is that the kind you're talking about?
All people who feel the situation has abandoned them to some hopeless condition.
Come over to the window, my little darling. I'd like to try to read your poem. I used to think I was some kind of gypsy boy before I let you take me home. Now so long, Marianne, it's time we began to lie and cry and cry and lie. Well, you know that I love to live with you, but you make me forget so very much. I forget to pray for the angels, and then the angels forget to pray for us. Ah, so long, Marianne. It's time that we began to laugh and cry and cry and laugh about it all again.
Your body lost in legends. the beast so very tame.
How do you feel your particular take on romanticism? How do you feel that's been interpreted over the years? How have people responded over time?
I've never known precisely what a romantic was. And black romantic, I've been described as a black romantic. I don't really know what that is either. That's a romantic can tell a joke about it. I really don't know what the whole category signifies. I studied the romantic poets when I was in university, and
Keats and
Keats, Shelley, Wordsworth. I liked Wordsworth very much. I liked Keats. I liked Shelley. There were certain postures that they took that I found difficult to embrace.
Namely?
Just the kind of vocative address, oh, nightingale. But now I understand it.
As you understand it now, how did it work?
It's glorious stuff. It's glorious stuff.
Truly spiritual, would you say?
I don't know. I'm not so sure what spiritual is either. It's very. I've had a great problem separating the spirit from the flesh. I see no reason why it should be separated.
Mask to to stand as somebody's man. Is this another form of disguise?
Well, the song grew out of a situation in which I had lost the one I loved and was trying to worm my way back into her affection. And this song was one of the many tries I made in that direction.
Here I stand, I'm your man.
I wanted to write an unconditional declaration of intention. It helped.
Step into the ring for you.
So, is this a tradition of yours to try to, I wouldn't say seduce a woman, but to engage a woman in body and soul by writing a song for her personally?
The songs I've written for women over the past 20 years have usually been personal addresses, yes. I've been speaking to a specific woman in a direct and intimate way.
What, there was a Suzanne?
Well, that the Suzanne's, there was a woman named Suzanne who took me down to her place near the St. Lawrence River and fed me constant comment tea, which is composed of tea and orange rind. And the landscape of the song is the Montreal Harbor. There's a church there called Notre Dame de Bon Secours. There's a virgin that looks out over the harbor, a golden virgin. The sun hits it at certain moments of the day.
And she feeds you tea and oranges that come all the way.
Are you in love with the idea of being in love? Is love the, let's say, air you would try to breathe?
She is wearing rags and feathers from a Salvation Army counter.
Rags have a special meaning for you. Rags and feathers and Suzanne, do not dress in those rags for me. Avalanche, rags of light, I'll dress to kill if it be your will. What is that meaning for you?
I suppose it means that we all are beggars. Beggars for grace, beggars for love, beggars for money, beggars for attention, beggars for significance.
Even though we may not come off that way,
we seem to lead lives of... I think that what I said before is clear. We exist. We live our lives as beggars.
We'll gather at the brokenness, breathe it to me now. The fragrance of those promises you never dared to vow. The splinters that you carry, the cross you left behind. Come healing of the body, come healing of the mind.
Amen. Amen.
the rivers fill. Let the hills rejoice. Let your mercy spill on all these burning hearts in hell. If it be your will to make us well. Draw us near, oh, bind us tight. All your children here in their rags of light, in our rags of light, all dressed to kill. This night, if it be your will, if it be your will. Amen. Amen.